Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 12th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on the agenda this morning is for members of the committee to consider taking agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we agreed? Yes, we are agreed. Thank you. We've got two evidence sessions this morning. The second is with Audit Scotland, the Auditor General, on the new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides report. But before that, we've got a session where we are taking evidence on the Audit Scotland briefing on social care, which came out recently. And I'm delighted to welcome our four witnesses online this morning. We're joined by Caroline Lamb, who's the Chief Executive for the NHS in Scotland and the Director General for Health and Social Care. Good morning. Donna Bell is the Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development in the Scottish Government. Good morning to you. We're also joined by two representatives from the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, Nicola Dickey, who's the Director of People and Policy at COSLA, and Sarah Waters, who's the Director of Membership and Resources at COSLA. You're very welcome too. What I'm going to do is, first of all, invite Caroline Lamb and Nicola Dickey to make short opening statements, and then we've got a series of questions which we would like to put to you. Because you're all online, if you do want to come in, please use the chat room function to indicate that, and we will do our level best to bring you in. And similarly, particularly to Caroline and Nicola, if you want to bring in Donna and Sarah, just let us know, and or speak as such, and we'll make sure that they are called in too. So, without further ado, can I invite Caroline Lamb to give us a short opening statement? Caroline.
Thank you very much, convener. The Audit Scotland report acknowledges that our commitment to a national care service indicates our recognition of the significant challenge within social care in Scotland. Indeed, the findings of the report were largely in line with the independent review of adult social care led by Derek Feely, which is precisely why we're acting to further increase investment in social care and to deliver a national care service by the end of this parliament. But ministers are clear that we shouldn't wait to establish the national care service in order to take action where it's needed. As such, as I've said, we will increase public investment in social care by 25% over this parliament. So by the end of the parliament, we'll have budgeted over 800 million of increased annual support compared to current spending. And in the latest programme for government, ministers restated their commitment to transformative social care, including developing options for the removal of non-residential charging for adult social care. Importantly, we've also agreed a joint statement of intent with COSLA in March 2020. And in that statement, we agreed to work together to advance the key foundation principles of the independent review. That included work on many of the areas identified by Audit Scotland as requiring improvement. And I'm happy, along with my colleagues, to answer questions on any of those areas, and particularly to expand on the action that we've taken and continue to take forward to support attraction, recruitment and retention of the workforce, on data improvement, on self-directed support, and the development and implementation of the healthcare framework for adults living in care homes in Scotland. Throughout all of this work, we are committed to listening to the voices of those with lived experience. Those conversations are already influencing our review of self-directed support. And keeping those with lived experience at the heart of our decision making is what will help us to shape a system that will improve future services and make things better for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Caroline Lamb, and that covers many of the areas that we do want to probe into in our questions this morning. So thanks for that opening statement. I'm now going to turn to Nicola Dickey, who's the Director of People and Policy at COSLA. Nicola.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to you and the committee. So thanks for inviting us along today to discuss Audit Scotland's social care briefing and the stark but important issues that it highlights. We know that the pandemic has put exceptional pressure on the whole system, on the entire workforce, on unpaid carers and those with lived experience accessing social care support. But we also know that many of the issues highlighted by Audit Scotland are not new. They are in many ways issues we have consistently highlighted for many years now as requiring meaningful attention and the whole system preventative investment. As COSLA has stated for many years now, there is a pressing need for national and local government, as well as our partners in the social care sector and trade unions, to work in partnership and, given the current pressures, at pace to address these challenges. Local government recognises that we cannot stand still if we want to create meaningful change and improve the outcomes for the people and the communities that we serve. We also know that we cannot wait for the creation of a national care service, nor can we be distracted by the challenges that come with the structural reform that is proposed. We are committed to acting now and implementing much of the change that is called for within the report. In March, as Caroline's already alluded to, COSLA and Scottish Government committed to a joint statement of intent, which set out ways we work together to deliver the key foundation pillars that, were set out within the Independent Review of Adult Social Care. Fundamental to that statement of intent was the recognition of the importance of empowering people, valuing our workforce, and indeed embedding a human rights-based approach to social care. We have continued to work jointly to deliver on this through progressing the recommendations of the Work Convention report on social care, working to ensure that commissioned social care workforce can see improved pay and conditions, career which fosters continuous learning and development. Ensuring a stable, skilled and valued social care workforce is a key priority that is shared between COSLA and Scottish Government. However, many of the issues requiring reform are not simple and have been challenged by the ongoing and significant issues caused by the pandemic, as well as the ongoing pressures on the core local government funding. We also know that progress has not happened at the pace we would wish to see, and there is now a shared sense of urgency across the system to address this. Put simply, local government is trying to deliver more with less. But I would urge committee members not to just consider the social care sector in isolation system. Many of the services and supports in our local communities that keep people healthy, connected, engaged and happier are the wider determinants of health that prevent individuals and carers from reaching crisis point. Investment in local government is investment in prevention and wellbeing, which is why we share the ambition of Scottish Government that everyone in Scotland can live well locally. This is reflected in Local Government Blueprint, which COSLA published, and indeed in the recent programme for government that Caroline mentioned. Local government is at the heart of this ambition, but we need fair funding to do so, and I'm sure we'll pick up some of those issues in more detail. I look forward to discussing some of these points in more detail with members, and thank you again for your invite this morning.
Well, again, thanks to you, Nicola, for that opening statement. I'm going to invite members of the committee to come in with some questions, but I just wanted to begin by reflecting on what the Auditor General told this committee when he appeared before us on the 3rd of March to talk about the social care briefing that he had produced. And what he said in his opening statement was, the Scottish Government needs to take a pragmatic approach and set out what can be improved now, without legislation, while taking time to determine where the National Care Service can add most value. And you've both spoken about a statement of intents and joint partnership proposals. I guess my question is, what's happening right now? What's your action plan? What steps are you taking at the moment? And I'll begin with Caroline Lamb.
Thanks very much. So, the joint statement of intent that was published in March 2020 had a number of key aspects that Nicola's outlined. I think in his evidence, the Auditor General had quite a clear focus on workforce, on data and on collaboration. In terms of workforce, we have worked with the Fair Work Group to develop a minimum standard framework for terms and conditions. That has been fully agreed and identified, and we are now working together with COSLA and other partners on the most efficient and effective mechanism of enabling those to be delivered. Of course, part of that, but not all of it, is about rates of pay, and the committee will be aware that from April, Scottish Government have provided funding to increase the minimum hourly rate paid to social care workers to £10.50. That's an increase of 12.9% from £9.30. So it did stand at £9.30 and then went up to £10.02 in December and up to £10.50 from April. So that, I think, represents absolutely real progress. On top of that, there's a whole load of other actions that we have been taking around workforce, and I'm happy to talk through those right now, Convener, but I'm conscious that might take a wee while to get through them all. There's a lot of activity that's been going on around both attraction, so national recruitment campaigns, waiving the cost of the recruitment portal My Job Scotland, which has seen over 40,000 clicks on the apply button since that happened, waiving the costs of registration with SSSC and PVG checks, accelerating PVG checks so we can get people who are applying into social care through that process faster. We've also set up a round table with employers to talk about some of the ways to best use recruitment fairs, and are currently running a series of recruitment fairs supported by DWP. We've looked at what the impact has been of the changes in freedom of movement, and note that care workers have been added to the shortage occupation lists, but that there are some challenges around that because very often it's a workforce that are employed part-time. We've also looked at what we can do around increasing the valuing of the workforce through having good, strong opportunities for development and career progression. So we worked with NES and the SSSC to establish an induction package that went live earlier this year, and we're continuing to work around those routes into social care and flexible routes that will enable people to develop their careers within the sector up to the levels of advanced practice. So there has been a huge amount of work that has been delivered in partnership in that area, and that's just around some of the issues that the Auditor General identified around workforce. We've also made progress, I think, on data, which is one of the areas that he highlighted. And I can come back. I'm sure you'll have questions in another number of other areas, but I don't want to preempt all of those. So I'll maybe just pause there. Nicola might want to pick up on some of the other areas.
Thank you, and I will bring Nicola in. I mean, I think the we view the report as quite rightly focusing on the value of the workforce, and we've got some questions on that. But the report addresses other areas too, doesn't it? Like the voice of service users, like the whole commissioning model and how that's working and whether that's delivering what we would want to see. So. But we are under some time constraints, and so we will come to those. We'll come to those areas in time. But I do want to give Nicola Dickey an opportunity to answer the question which I put, which was about the pragmatic approach and what practical steps are being taken now. Nicola.
Yeah, thanks very much. So I won't go back over what Caroline has said, because as Caroline has quite rightly said, it was all done in partnership around about increasing the hourly rate, et cetera, and local government and Scottish Government working partnership to deliver that. It's just two things I wanted to bring kind of in and on top of that. Obviously, we had a very critical period with Omicron just before Christmas time, and indeed that saw local government actually move to redeploy and shuffle staff in to support the social care workforce from the wider local government workforce, and that included keeping them within our own services, but also moving them into commissioned services where that was required. So I suppose that's a really practical way that the rest of the local government workforce, and indeed the rest of local government, has supported social care. So that was one, but I appreciate that specific to Omicron. And the other thing I would just like to kind of mention is that working in partnership just at the start of kind of this year, we have obviously published the National Workforce Strategy for Health and Social Care, which is an integrated strategy. So those were just the two things that came to mind after Caroline gave the list of things that we've done jointly. Thanks, Convener.
Right, thank you very much indeed. The second question I've got is just really to ask you both whether or not you accept the recommendations which are in paragraphs 35 to 38 of the report. Do you accept the recommendations which are set out in this Audit Scotland report? Caroline Lamb, first of all.
Yes, I think... Sorry, just checking my microphone's on. Yes, I think that Scottish Government accepts the recommendation and is already taking forward action with partners in many of these areas.
Nicola, on behalf of COSLA.
Yeah, Yeah, I mean, I think there's not anything in the general report that we would disagree with. And I think, as Caroline's alluded to, many of these issues are ones that we were already actively working on and indeed to address. I don't know whether Donna might want to come in on the actual specifics.
Donna Bell, do you want to add to that?
All I would add to that is that all of the themes that have been identified by Audit Scotland are very much on our radar. There is very little in there, in fact, nothing in there that we aren't already aware of and are working on. So I think I would agree with Caroline, really.
Okay, thanks very much. As I say, we will we will return to some of these themes as we go on. I mean, I have to say, I think the concern we've got, and one of the threads that runs through the Audit Scotland report, is A, the need for a sense of urgency, and B, an understanding that it's not just on your agenda, but that there is an action plan with force behind it, which is leading to change. I'm going to now invite Craig Hoy to ask a series of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. The Scottish Government is obviously planning very significant reforms to social care in Scotland, and extending beyond through residential social care through plans for a national care service. The commitment seems absolute to proceed with reform, but the planning for that reform is obviously still at an early stage, and you know, the ink is barely dry on the consultation. But it is quite clear that during the period as we move towards those reforms and that wide-scale structural reform, that there are significant urgent needs, both short-term and long-term, therefore. What levels of investment do you believe are required to meet today's needs and to implement future social care reform? And given that local government in Scotland has been chronically underfunded over the last decade by this government, do you have confidence that the funds will be forthcoming to meet both the short-term needs and the long-term structural requirements? And I suppose Caroline, probably the best person to start with that.
Yes, okay, thank you for that question. Yes, as you've said, I think the National Care Service is a really ambitious and very important reform. And the pandemic has made that case for change even more urgent in the way in which it's shone a light on some of the issues in social care. So we are committed to establishing a functioning National Care Service by the end of this parliamentary term. But ministers, as you said, the ink is barely dry in the consultation. The ministers are considering the wealth of information that came in through that consultation. And we're continuing to engage with people who access and deliver services as we think about the next steps. As I've already indicated, we are committed to increasing the level of investment in social care by 25%. Over the course of this parliament, and as part of the work that we will be getting into around planning for the detail of a national care service, we will of course be doing the work to assess exactly what will be required, both in terms of funding, but also how we can look at this across the whole of the system of health and social care, and for example, where there are opportunities to see expenditure shifted towards community services so that we can get into much more of a preventive and proactive space. And Donna, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Donna Bell, I don't know whether you want to supplement Caroline's comments there.
I think we may have lost Donna.
Yes. Craig, back to you, I think.
I just wonder whether Nicola, from a COSLA perspective, might want to reflect on the financial pressures that local government have traditionally experienced recently and what might happen during that interim period where potentially we see a significant hollowing out of local government with social care being transferred to being moved under ministerial control.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll maybe give you my opinion from a kind of social care perspective and bring in Sarah on the wider finance point, but I suppose we have to think about what it is we want the current system to achieve. So Caroline's already mentioned that Scottish ministers have made a commitment by the end of Parliament to increase spending. I suppose from a local government and I suppose from someone who's accessing services perspective, it's are we comfortable that the existing social care system continues to deliver what it is doing now, recognising that the Auditor General's report recognises that thresholds and access to services is at a a really high level. So I think that the 25% increase by the end of Parliament is welcome, but are we comfortable that that will achieve more than we are doing just now within the existing system? I don't know that we are. With regard to the finances associated with the National Care Service, COSLA, you know, discussed extensively with Derek Feely when he was doing his independent review of adult social care report that the funding that's in the current system and indeed the wider local government funding that actually supports social care. So if you ask me to describe it, I would say local government funding is the branch of the tree in social care and indeed health and indeed public health hangs off the core local government services that we provide, given that so many of the services that local government provides do so much to improve the life of those accessing social care. So I think are we comfortable that there's enough money in the system for the current social care system as we understand it, recognising there are improvements that need to be made? Is the 25% increase enough to help us, you know, even deliver what we are delivering at the moment? I think that's a question mark. And I think in terms of is the associated funding that government ministers have suggested will be required for the National Care Service adequate? The difficulty is that Derek Feely only costed adult social care. We now have proposals on the table that bring in other things. So if you were asking me to put a figure on it at the moment, that would be very difficult because I don't know exactly what will go into it. And as you say, that is quite rightly because the consultation is finished and indeed the bill will come forward with a financial measure, which, as you would expect, COSLA are very keen to. But I might bring Sarah in on the local government financing more generally, if that's okay.
Thanks, Nicola. Yeah, happy to come in at that point. I think one of the main points that I think COSLA has continued to make, and we've made it, I think, quite clearly, excuse me, in our submission to the resource spending review, which we submitted a couple of weeks ago. I think one of the fundamental issues is that we absolutely accept that more cash has gone into local government over recent years. And I think, you know, we can't argue with that. But actually, when you look at what is defined within the Scottish budget as general revenue and core grant, that has actually flatlined since 13-14. And the problem is when we add the new funding on top of this, if there is inadequate policy funding for the commitments that are already in the system, we have to kind of take from the core funding to prop up commitments, for example, where they haven't been funded and there's been increased demand or increased costs. So that is that's where the real pressure point is. It's that flatlining of the core, which I think Audit Scotland have highlighted in their local government finance overview, that is actually a significant real-term cut when there's actually been increases passed to both Scottish government and to other parts of the wider system. And I think that the whole thrust of the campaign this year from COSLA was about, you know, it's the other services that are within communities that are the things that not only keep people out of the National Health Service, but that actually ultimately can keep people out of the National Care Service or keep them at the lowest level of care that they require. So instead of costly, complex interventions, actually some of the simpler things that we can do upstream in terms of lunch clubs, community learning, mental health support, transport, we need to look at those services, and that's where the core funding is the particular issue. I think just on the wider issue of actually extracting social care from local government, I think that is extremely complex. If we look at some areas, for example, catering and cleaning services are inextricably linked to other council services. So you may have a catering service that caters for adult social care and schools and other parts of local government service, transport services. There's a whole range of services and support services as well within councils, their back office functions, which, as the Auditor General has pointed out through the supplying evidence on the local government benchmarking framework, those services have taken a hit over the years. And I think it'll be really complex to try and kind of unwind some of those and extract them from local government without a real detrimental impact in local government.
The Auditor General draws attention to that in his report. I think stakeholders raise concerns, not just about doing it in relation to adult social care, but also the wider scale of the reforms and the impact it could have on local government. The tension, obviously, the financial tension is quite significant. The other tension is that during the process over the next 3 to 5 years is that the urgent need that the Auditor General identifies within his report in relation to social care is somehow pushed out because of the structural reform process that is will need to be undertaken in order to achieve that. So, Caroline Lamb, I suppose, what assurance can you give the committee that there will be a clear timescale for developing a plan to address the urgent issues within the system? And how is it going to be possible to implement longer-term reform, for example, with councils if they're allocating capital budgets or in relation to reprovisioning of care services? Isn't there a very real risk that that will be pushed off the table, and even though it is in many respects urgent, because of this longer-term structural review?
So we are absolutely focused on the immediate and the urgent pressures. In our winter response plan, we announced 300 million additional funding, of which 170 million was into social care, recognising that absolute interdependency between health and social care. We need all bits of the system to be delivering the best possible value that they can. And whilst I understand the focus on budgets and budget management and resources, it's also really important that we look at what we're delivering in terms of outcomes and quality for people. So we need to make sure that we're spending the money that we have in the best possible way to achieve the best outcomes for people. And I think so long as all of us across the system remain focused on achieving those best outcomes for people, then we will continue to improve the system as we move towards reform.
Finally, obviously, reform of this scale will involve significant changes to governance, to accountability, collaboration, and require some degree of new leadership. To what extent can the Scottish Government learn from previous wide-scale reforms, and how do we avoid having a Police Scotland Mark II as the product of this?
I'll maybe start on this, but I'll bring Donna in, because we are absolutely mindful of the way in which both maybe policy has not been implemented as well as we might have liked in the past, and also learning the lessons from previous large-scale reforms, so including Police Scotland, but also things like Social Security Scotland as well, and learning from what's gone really well, but also learning the lessons from the things that haven't gone as well. But Donna, do you want to come in on those points?
Yeah, thanks, Caroline. And I suppose just on the previous discussion around the urgency and a coherent plan for improvement, there is, as you've already described, Caroline, a number of actions that are underway. So around SDS reform, and we have a really good collaborative group of people working on that to develop an improvement programme at the moment. You've already covered a lot of the recruitment and retention challenges and the actions that we're taking there. There is a range of other work focusing on residential settings for adults, particularly in care homes, and the healthcare framework that we're proposing to implement there. We have work on a different practice model to support a holistic approach to people, as you've described. The work on multidisciplinary teams, which will support that, has been moving forward at pace over the past year or so. The intention is we're meeting with local government colleagues next week to discuss wider improvements as well. And I would expect, and Nicola may wish to comment on this, certainly the commitment from Scottish Government and from local government to draw together that coherent improvement programme and then to implement that at pace, certainly post the local government election, is absolutely at the top of our agenda. On the learning from other pieces of reform or change, certainly we have done a significant amount of work to learn from integration of health and social care thus far. We also engage regularly with the people who have undertaken both police and fire reform, the setup of the Social Security Agency, and others, actually, to understand what has worked really well for them, but also the things that they might want to do differently in the future. So we have a good cohort of colleagues and advice from those people on major reform programmes and change management. So we're drawing all of that, not just into our discussions about the future National Care Service, but also about the reform that we want to undertake now and the improvements that we want to make.
Fine. And just a very brief closing question, if I may, in relation to data and how data gaps are going to be addressed. It's quite clear that, there are data gaps on demand and unmet need, for example. So how do you intend to plug those gaps now, and as you move forward to a more integrated system with social care and the NHS, how will you make sure that you align that data and integrate that data so that you get a better product at the end of it?
Yeah, thank you. So yeah, data is an area that I have a particular interest in, and in the NCS consultation we set out a plan for a nationally consistent and integrated and accessible health and social care record, and an intention that, we would use legislation to make sure that there is appropriate sharing of data and data standards, which makes it so much easier to share data. But this is another one of those things that we can't wait for. And indeed, we haven't been waiting. And I think that we have made important progress through the pandemic and through the pressures that we've faced. To give you one example, we implemented the TURAS Care Home Safety Huddle tool, which has provided information that's been absolutely critical to our pandemic response. It's provided a timely, standardised data set for each adult care home across Scotland, which has been incredibly useful to providers, to oversight groups, to health and social care partnerships, and indeed to us nationally. So that sort of work has made and continues to make a difference, with also a big focus of taking the work out of data collection. So it's a very simple system, not lots of complex spreadsheets. We've also implemented a data improvement programme. So we're working with partners again, to identify what the barriers are to achieving improvements in the short term and as quickly as possible. And I think you referred to the data gaps across the health and social care system, and that focus on management information is absolutely critical. I've mentioned already how the interdependencies across health and social care, and in terms of understanding how we can best make the system work for people, we absolutely need to be understanding what the pressures are, what the demand is at each point in that system. And particularly through the pressures that the system have been under, our adult social care gold group has worked in partnership to develop key sets of management information, which is really helping in terms of our understanding of how the system is working end to end. There is still work to do with that in terms of improving quality, timeliness and consistency of the data. So I'm not underestimating the challenge, but it is something that all partners are committed to working on. And hopefully I'll have the opportunity a bit later in the session, I don't want to lose up too much time, just to talk about what that data I think is starting to mean in real life for people working in the system. Thank you.
Thanks much, Richard.
Thank you. I think Donna Bell wanted to come in on that point as well. Donna, do you want to speak?
Yeah, thanks, convener. And it was just to pick up on the point that Caroline made about the Gold Group, which is a multi-agency group who have been brought together over the pandemic to better understand the issues that are emerging and that are live for us all. There has been a significant focus on that group and on data, and specifically, as Karen said, around outbreaks in care homes, on pressures in the system, particularly unmet need, and things like workforce absence, workforce supply, etc. And Nicola might want to come in here too, but certainly that has given us a better shared understanding of the pressures in the system, certainly over the past year. As Caroline says, I think there's a lot more work to do on quality and probably to expand that data set significantly, because what it does at the moment is it captures known unmet need at a management information level. So people who are waiting for assessments or for packages of care, but it doesn't cover wider unmet need perhaps in the community at a more preventative or early intervention level. So I think there is a significant amount of work to do, but we have made a lot of progress over the last year.
Okay, thanks. We are, as I mentioned at the beginning, quite pressed for time. So if you could try and keep your answers concise, that would be really helpful. But I'm going to invite Willie Coffey, who's got some questions in this area as well, to come in. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's really a question to follow up on what Craig Hoy was asking just there on funding and sustainability. If you look at the figures that the Auditor-General presented to us in terms of adult social care spend, you can see significant increases in the spend over the last 10 years. In fact, the spend has gone up by 22% for adult social care. And we heard Caroline saying just a moment ago that we plan to spend more, another 25% more on this. So the bottom line question for me, Convener, is with that additional funding and the whole service redesign come through the National Care Service, is that going to be adequate? Will that be adequate to address the concerns that the Auditor General expressed about sustainability of the service going ahead? Could you give us your view on that, Caroline, please, and some kind of reassurance, if you can?
So I think the additional funding that we've already made available into the system is making a difference, and that commitment over the term of this Parliament is really important. I think we've still got more work to do to understand demand and the nature of demand, and to understand as well whether we are addressing that demand at the most appropriate point. So are we providing support to people early enough to prevent them from being in a position of needing more support by not being able to access the support that they need early? So I think there is still a lot of work to be done. I think as well we're still understanding the impact of the pandemic on some parts of society, and the extent to which for the elderly population not being able to get out and do the things that they would normally do has actually had a detrimental impact in how we can assess that and how we can meet that demand going forward. So I think that the answer to your question is we've still got work to do just to bottom out absolutely what we're expecting in terms of demand, and to start to do some scenario planning looking at that going forwards.
For now, Convener, I know we're really pressed for time, but thank you for that answer.
Thanks, Willie. I'm going to now turn to Sharon Dowie, who's got a couple of questions to put. Sharon.
Good morning. Service users and carers do not always have a say or choice about what support works best for them. Self-directed support, SDS, was designed to give people choice and control over their care, including personalised options for carers to take short breaks from caring. SDS has not yet been fully implemented. People using social care support have described the hurdles encountered in accessing services and described accessing support as a battle, difficult, overcomplicated and bureaucratic. The pandemic has highlighted the precarious situation of many vulnerable people who rely on social care or support, and has had a negative impact on people requiring support. The Scottish Human Rights Commission has expressed deep concern about future levels of social care support likely to be available to people whose packages were reduced or withdrawn during the pandemic. Can you tell us how the Scottish Government is involving service users and carers in reforming social care services? Caroline Lamb wants to come in.
Thank you. In my opening remarks, I talked about how conversations with people with lived experience were already influencing our review of self-directed support. But I'll ask Donna to say a bit more on that, and Nicola might want to say something about consistency of implementation. Donna.
Thanks, Caroline. So I mentioned when I spoke earlier about the work that we're doing to revisit the self-directed support guidance. And we're really clear that guidance alone is necessary but not sufficient to making the change that we need to see on self-directed support. And there is an implementation gap, I think we're all clear about that. So we're working with a group, a fairly broad group, which includes people with lived experience, people who have caring responsibilities, who agree a way forward there in terms of that improvement. We've had, I think, now two short life working groups meeting as a part of that review, and we've got a number of key themes that have been identified, which I think are concur with what the member has said. So there is work to do on effective decision making and consistency on decision making, and also considering whether there is any conflict in legislation and policies. We do support the Support in the Right Direction programme as well, which provides support and advocacy too. So we're very keen to draw all of that together and put in place a set of improvement actions to make sure that there is much more consistency, access is more streamlined, and that people can get what they need from self-directed support.
Okay, was Nicola coming in?
Nicola Dickey, do you want to come in on that point?
Yeah, thanks very much. I suppose so absolutely to concur with what Donna's just said there about voice of lived experience coming through. I suppose the Minister's also established a social covenant group where we've got service users directly providing their opinion on indeed current social care and indeed the reforms that will come. And COSLA's Health and Social Care spokesperson, Councillor Stuart Curry, also sits on that group. So hears at a political level directly from service users, which is good. Myself and Donna, over the period of the pandemic, I've also chaired what was termed as the Pandemic Response and Adult Social Care Group. And on that group as well, we had unpaid carers reps and carers associations and other people who represented service users on that. So I think we're getting better. There is always more to do. I would also point out that local government hears from users of social care every single day in every community up and down the length and breadth of the country. And I'm sure if you had a local councillor here today, they would tell you they get lots of experience and feedback, as I'm sure members of the committee do. Just to come back to the point around about localisation and unmet need, I think we have to be absolutely clear the difference in outcome of experience versus the outcomes that people actually access. So COSLA is an avid believer that the access to support that you get in Shetland, the process should be the same, but the actual outcome might be different, because how you get supported with social care needs on Shetland may well be very different to how you are supported with your social care needs in the centre of Glasgow. And I think we can agree that's true, because people are individuals. So it goes back to the point that I was making in my opening remarks, that we need to make sure that what we are seeing in person-centred outcomes, and we need to get away from the idea that a nationalised model will support individualised outcomes. What a national model may well support is similar outcomes, and one size fits all is something that we've worked hard through the process of. I'm not going to sit here and say that it's all perfect, because it's not. We've already alluded to the challenges that we've got with the demographics in Scotland. We've already spoken about the financial challenges that we've got. And I think the other thing we need to think about is that the pandemic did not hit all of our communities equally at the one time. So what we heard during the pandemic was, well, why are day services, for example, still closed in X authority, but they're open in Y authority? Because the pandemic wasn't felt the same across our cities as it was in some of our rural. So I think we just need to be really careful that we don't strive for a one-size-fits-all and then move away from what we've been talking about for a very long time, going back to Campbell Christie, which is prevention and indeed person-centred outcomes. So I think from a local government perspective and the way COSLA has approached both the independent review and indeed the Scottish Government consultation, is not saying everybody should get the same. What we're saying is everyone should get the same support and should go through the same journey, but ultimately the outcomes might be the same. Thanks.
Thank you. And just The pandemic has also put additional pressures on unpaid carers owing to the closure of day centres and respite services. This has resulted in increased feelings of anxiety, depression and mental exhaustion. Are you aware at the moment of whether all of these facilities have opened back up post-pandemic? And if they haven't opened back up, what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that these services are opened to give the people the support that they need? I don't know if Nicola wants to come in on that, or...
So I can't speak for the Scottish Government, but I can certainly tell you from a local government perspective, we recognise, obviously, the closure of day centres in the very height of the early days of the pandemic was on the basis of public health guidance, and that we didn't want people who were vulnerable, or at that time, as they were coined, they were shielding, being put into day centres where they maybe had difficulties with increased access to the virus. So I think we have to remember that there was a public health reason for day centres being closed. I think from a local government and indeed a health and social care partnership, people recognised absolutely the importance of getting those day centres back up and running for people if they wanted them. Because I think going back to the point, what local government did with our partners when the day centres were closed was we tried to step in to a space and give a person-centred approach to what might work for those individuals who'd previously been in day centres. I think for very obvious reasons there was some nervousness about, instead of someone going to a day centre, a service worker coming and accessing a person who accesses support in their own home when they were shielding. So I think that there was an element of when the day centres closed, we did try and step in and provide support. There was a bit of reticence in some respects. There was also workforce challenges from a local government perspective. So I think during the course of the pandemic, the way we've approached day centres has changed, and it has changed not always for the same reason. Some of it was very early on public health advice. These are high-risk settings and shouldn't necessarily be operating. I think as we're coming back through the pandemic, those day services where there is still a requirement, and that's what local support and service users want, have opened back up. I think local government has in some areas taken the opportunity to reform the services. So we've maybe moved away as people have moved into other things. But I think we just need to be, going back to my point about localisation, I think it's difficult when we start to say, we had 150 before the pandemic and we've got 140 now. That might not always be a bad thing, because if people have gone elsewhere or they've started to access different supports, that's exactly where we want people to go. Because going back to the point about choice and responsibility and personal support, that might be a good thing. But Donna might want to come in terms of the Scottish Government's approach to day services.
Thanks, Nicola. So you've covered most of it. All I was proposing to say is that we've worked really closely together on making sure that the guidance is right, working with Public Health Scotland and others to ensure that folk are supported to open up as and when they can. Mr Stewart, Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, wrote out last year to encourage day centres to open back up. But I think, Nicola, you've covered the primary points on localisation there. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Sharon Dowie asked about commissioning, and I guess I would like to ask Caroline Lamb, who is the Chief Executive for NHS Scotland, as well as the Director General for Health and Social Care, about this commissioning model. I mean, if we look at the National Health Service, the commissioning model is not the model of the National Health Service, is it? And arguably, there would be an outcry if we went down that route as the model of delivering the NHS. So as part of the discussions that you've been having with COSLA and looking indeed into the National Care Service of the future, I mean, are you looking at alternatives to a competitive tendering model, which is how the commissioning model has developed?
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. So I think probably what's key around this is that within the independent review recommendations, there was a recommendation which is also part of the joint statement of intent with COSLA to move towards ethical commissioning. So that's much more about a partnership approach to commissioning and a focus on the outcomes and what's important to people in amongst that. We have started the process of engaging on draft ethical standards, and Donna can say more on that. In preparation for the move towards the recommendations from the independent review, we also issued a Scottish procurement policy notice in December, which was designed with key stakeholders and advising of the actions that they can already take in commissioning and procurement and how we can make improvements on that. I'll maybe ask Donna to come in around some of the detail of that work on ethical commissioning.
Okay, thanks, Karen. And so I think the procurement guidance that was issued in December is a really important starting point there, because there is a lot that can be done just now to bring current activity in line with the principles of ethical commissioning. I think there's a lot of work to do. We've had some really great input from CCPS and from others on where we might go with this. It's not straightforward, so there is a significant amount of work to do, which will take a bit of time. I think, though, a focus on what can be done now is really important, and colleagues in local government have been again working closely with us on what can be done now, so it's maybe worth asking them to give us a bit of comment on that too.
Thanks. I think Sarah Waters wants to come in, so I'm going to invite Sarah to comment on that.
So it wasn't a point specifically on the last point that Donna made, but it was just really in relation to ethical commissioning. I mean, this is something, you know, local government takes its commissioning across, you know, a range of services really, really seriously. And, you know, not as well as ethical commissioning, there's sustainable commissioning, there's local commissioning, and many, many councils are now working on things, you know, community wealth building strategies. So actually, it's something that, you know, this is only one part of what local government does. It is trying to make sure that we are getting the best value for local communities right through the commissioning process. It's really challenging, though, and I come back to it, and the Auditor General has said it, with single year budgets, this is just really challenging. You're continually having one eye on next year and the year after and what you're going to have to do. But certainly ethical commissioning, as I say, is just one part of a whole range of commissioning approaches that councils are trying to take.
Thank you. In and amongst those answers, I didn't hear anywhere anybody talking about going beyond commissioning or looking to a conversion to more of a National Health Service model for the National Care Service. But we are pressed for time, so I'm going to move on. We've covered quite a lot on the workforce so far. My kind of parting question on that before I bring Colin Beattie in is just to ask, you mentioned, Caroline Lamb, about the uprating of the hourly rate of pay from April of this year. Do you have any forward timetable of where you expect rates of pay to go over the next 5 years, the time horizon that you've spoken about, this 25% uplift in resources in?
So, no, within that 25% uplift, obviously pay will be one factor of that, but we haven't yet modelled out exactly what that would look like.
That's fine. That's clear. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to ask a final couple of questions. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to look at leadership. And leadership is a concern that's been raised depressingly often in the public sector. In this particular case, I'd draw your attention to paragraph 20 of the Auditor General's report, where it says that the health and social care sector needs stable and collaborative leadership to address the challenges. There's also reference to local government and Scotland overview of 2020, which emphasised the critical need for effective leadership, which wasn't there. And again, the NHS in Scotland 2020 report, which highlighted the lack of stable NHS senior leadership with high turnover and short-term posts. Now, these are quite serious issues. Leadership is absolutely vital, and yet so often we find it's not there. And here we are looking at the challenges facing social care, and they seem to be facing exactly the same issues in terms of leadership. Maybe Caroline Lamb might be able to comment on that and how this is being tackled.
Thank you. Happy to come in on that one, and I'm sure colleagues will want to contribute as well. So yes, I would agree the health and social care sector does need stable and collaborative leadership. That's not necessarily always about everybody staying in the same job. I think we see real benefits from people moving between health and social care. So we have examples of chief officers who've become chief executives in NHS boards, and I think that really helps to break down some of the barriers and enhance collective understanding of some of the challenges across the end-to-end system. However, it's absolutely the case as well that I think if we look at the impact of the pandemic over the last couple of years, it has put the workforce under extreme pressure, and it's also put our senior leaders under extreme pressure as well. And people have worked incredibly hard in the face of some, you know, quite extraordinary challenges. That said, I think it's also been a unifying factor. So I think it's actually brought people together. And certainly, as I speak to people around the country, most of them will comment positively on how the experience of COVID, of working together with clear priorities, has brought them together into a collaborative space and actually built relationships that were stronger than they were before and that will endure, I think, going forwards. I think that, you know, one of the things that we need to hang on to in terms of that collaborative leadership is that does become more complex as priorities start to become more complex as well. And there's a risk that focus and the single mission that we had through COVID gets a little bit diluted. But I'm sorry, I'm choking a little bit. So I'll maybe just pass to Donna, who can talk you through some of the things that we're doing to support leaders and leadership across the system. Donna.
Yeah, thank you. So we do work very closely with chief officers in particular. So the support that is offered to them includes a range of, they're actually a very good self-supporting network. And I think that has led to some great connections, practice sharing, and a good leadership cadre there who support each other. There is activity in place to support wellbeing for leadership, coaching and various other aspects. But I think the point that Caroline makes about that collaboration point, people learning together and people coming together to address joint challenges is a really, really important one. And as Caroline says, a lot of well, we could call it learning on the job and collaborating on the job over the past few years has brought people much more closely together to understand their common challenges. I think the focus on wellbeing is an important one. As Caroline says, it's been a very, very difficult time for a lot of the leadership operating in health and social care, which has both challenged people but helped them grow in their roles. So I think as we come out of this current period, there will be more to do, but certainly there is a fair amount of support in place already. Nicola might want to talk a wee bit about local government and any specifics that are in place there.
Before Nicola comes in, and that's that. The Auditor General's report here is at January 2022, and I applaud the optimism and everything expressed and all the collaborative, but it's not being evidenced in what's coming before this committee. And, you know, obviously it's going to take time before that feeds through, but at the moment, on the evidence that we see that's given to us, at the moment it's substandard, to be honest. Nicola.
So I absolutely agree with Caroline, what Caroline said around about COVID bringing leaders together. You know, COSLA's submission and indeed Solace, the Chief Exec's core submission to the Scottish Government consultation on the National Care Service flagged the risk of unstabilising the senior leadership within within health and social care and indeed the wider public sector. So I think it is a risk, and it's one that people are aware of. What I would say is there's an awful lot of support going into supporting all of Scotland's public sector leaders in terms of leading through change, because there's not a single part of the public sector in Scotland, social care included, that will not be leading through some form of change as we come out of the pandemic. So I think we've got the Scottish Leaders Forum set up. We've got various support networks there, but it is something certainly that the chief execs in local government, and indeed I'm sure, not to speak for them, but the chief execs in the NHS are absolutely mindful of. So do we have the golden bullet at the moment? I don't know, but it's certainly something that is on the risk list from a local government perspective to ensure that the senior leadership across local government and the wider public sector are supported, regardless of whatever the form of the National Care Service might be.
Just very briefly, because I am conscious of time, in paragraph 21 of the report, there's also reference made to the issues between partner organisations, the model of governance being overcomplicated. This is not new. These integration authorities have been in place for some time. And Donna, for example, said, oh, we've been learning from other integration initiatives such as police and so on. Again, I say, as at January 22, when this report was produced, there seems to be very little evidence of that coming through in the Auditor General's report. So I'm hearing a lot of good words. I don't see the evidence for it. And, you know, I hope that we will see that in the future. I don't know whether anyone wants to say anything further on the integration authorities. No?
I think Donna was wanting to come in, and I'd maybe just like to give a specific example around collaboration. Donna, do you want to come in first?
Thanks, Caroline. So the first reference that I made to understanding change and the need for change was to integration authorities. So we know Audit Scotland themselves have published a number of reports on learning from integration, and we obviously have a range of our own learning. So I absolutely recognise what the member says about the need for change, and I think that has come to fruition both through the Independent Review of Adult Social Care but also the proposals for the National Care Service. So I think both of those things, as well as all of the other work that is underway, are a direct response to the points that the member makes. So it's absolutely the case that we are learning from where we are now and are putting plans in place to address the issues that have been identified.
Okay, thank you very much. That ends the questions which the committee have got. So can I thank very much indeed Caroline Lamb and Donna Bell from the Scottish Government and Nicola Dickey, who may have dropped off, but nonetheless, if she can hear us, I hope she takes our thanks for her evidence, and Sarah Waters, who joined us, both from COSLA. As a committee, we'll reflect on the evidence that we've taken this morning and decide on what our next steps are. But thank you very much indeed for your cooperation this morning, and hope to see you again soon. Thank you. I'm now going to suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Well, can I welcome people back to the second half of this morning's Public Audit Committee. Agenda item three is our first consideration of the new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides Audit Scotland report into arrangements for the delivery of vessels 801 and 802. Can I welcome witnesses to the meeting this morning? The Auditor General, Stephen Boyle, who's joined with a team of three people this morning, Anthony Clark, who's the Interim Director of Performance, Audit and Best Value, Angela Canning, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland, and Jill Miller, who's an Audit Manager, Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland. We're also joined virtually this morning by a guest MSP who's taking part in the evidence session this morning, and that's the Highlands and Islands MSP, Rhoda Grant, who is joining us remotely. So, Rhoda, you are very welcome. And can I remind you that if you want to come in at any point in particular, if you indicate by putting an R in the chat room, and we'll do our best to bring you in. What I'd like to do to begin with is to invite the Auditor General to give us an opening statement. Then we've got a series of questions. And I have to say that we may not cover all of the ground that we need to cover this morning, in which case we might be looking to have a part two of this session with you, Auditor General. But I'm going to begin by inviting you to make an opening statement.
Convener, many thanks. Good morning, committee. Under Section 23 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000, I am bringing to the committee my performance audit report on the project to deliver two new ferries for the Clyde and Hebrides. The main headlines surrounding these two vessels are well known. They are significantly late and considerably over budget. My report sets out the reasons for the delays and cost overruns and the remaining challenges in completing the vessels. It highlights a multitude of failings over the last 6 years. In particular, my report highlights that Scottish ministers approved the contract award to Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited in October 2015 without the standard financial guarantees being in place and contrary to the advice of Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited, CMAL, the public body which owns most of the vessels on the network. There is insufficient documentary evidence to explain why these risks were accepted, and I consider that there should have been a proper record of this important decision. Only 2 months after the contract was awarded, CMAL identified concerns with the project, and over time, problems, delays and costs escalated. Scottish ministers approved several financial and non-financial interventions to try and get the project back on track, but these had little impact. FMEL entered administration in August 2019 following unresolved financial disputes with CMAL. By this point, the Scottish Government and CMAL had paid FMEL over £128 million, but the vessels remained far from complete. In December 2019, the Scottish Government nationalised the shipyard with the stated intention of helping to get the vessels completed as quickly as possible, protect jobs and sustain shipbuilding on the Clyde. Now operated by a public body, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, there are still major operational issues at the yard that remain unresolved and remedial work on the vessels, which should have been completed within 7 months, continue to be uncovered. Since my report was published, the new accountable officer of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow has updated Parliament to report that vessel 801 is now expected to be delivered between March and May 2023, 5 years later than promised, and vessel 802 between October and December 2023. These new vessels were intended to create more capacity and improve reliability across the Clyde and Hebrides network. They were also meant to bring social, economic and environmental benefits. That these have not yet been achieved over 6 years on is of course a source of frustration for island communities which rely upon lifeline ferries. It is imperative, therefore, that Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow delivers these vessels within the new timescales. Closer collaboration with CMAL is a positive step. But as I set out in my report, There are several operational and workforce challenges remaining that need to be addressed if these vessels are to be delivered. I make recommendations, convener, to help support this. After the vessels are completed, all public sector bodies involved must turn their attention to fully considering what went wrong with this project, learning lessons, and crucially preventing a repeat of such problems in the future. Convener, as ever, myself and my colleagues will do our utmost to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Right, thank you very much indeed, Auditor General, for that concise and very clear opening statement. I'm going to turn, first of all, to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who's got a number of questions to put. Sharon.
Good morning, Mr. Boyle. Good morning, everybody. So again, your team have provided a report which, in your words, have shown a multitude of failings. A comprehensive report, even with the lack of documentary evidence that was available, and it's obviously raised an awful lot of concerns and a lot more questions. Once again, the issue of transparency within the Scottish Government has been raised. The report makes it clear that the project's been riddled with problems and delays over 6 years. The vessel's now 4 years late, now looks like 5 years late. The cost 2.5 times the original budget at the moment. Worryingly, paragraph 105 states that the Scottish Government is committed to paying the additional vessel costs regardless of the final price. And all of this at the expense of the taxpayers and seemingly with no accountability from ministers. When we read paragraph 141, it states, because engines and equipment were purchased several years in advance, warranties have expired and any repairs required before vessel 801 enters service could be expensive and time-consuming. We now know that there will be delays due to cabling being too short for the vessels, and to add another layer to the saga, once the vessels eventually do come into service, there's now talk that the vessels are 40 metres too long for the harbour it serves, and that the masters of the boat who've been practising using simulators have been unable to dock them safely. So it seems the story will continue, the costs will continue to rise, and there may well be further delays. And that's before we start talking of flawed decision-making processes, lack of documentary evidence, and the Scottish Government ignoring alarm bells that have gone off repeatedly. So it's understandable why there's a lot of interest in the report. So going back to 2015 and moving on to my first question, looking at Exhibit 1, in August 2015, ministers announced Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited, or FMEL, as the preferred bidder. Could you tell me more about the decision-making in that? And I believe there was 7 bids from 6 companies. So who would have taken the decision to award the contract to FMEL, taking into account that it does say that FMEL was the most expensive bidder?
Good morning, Deputy Convener. In respect of Exhibit 1, what we looked at is to set out the very significant chain of events up to current day. Right at the start of that exhibit, we note the identification of FMEL as the preferred bidder. I'm going to bring colleague Jill Miller in a moment just to kind of talk the committee through the process around the procurement. But before doing so, I think it may be helpful just for the purposes of our report to set the scope of our work that we set out. We didn't review the detail of the procurement, the design arrangements of the ferry contract. In doing so, we took a judgment based on the evidence considered by the Rural Economy Committee in the previous session of the Parliament, having their investigation taking considerable evidence on the design arrangements and the procurement circumstances, that our work would be best served by picking up from the point of the identification of FMEL as the preferred bidder through to the current day and some of the circumstances and challenges that have unfolded therein. Nonetheless, in the report, we do give some of the history of the procurement circumstances, and I'll maybe invite Jill just to update the committee on some of the decisions arrived by the various parties, the use of cost quality indicators and so forth, if that would be helpful. Jill.
Hi there. Yes, as you said, in March 2015, CMAL received 7 bids from 6 shipbuilders. Just want to emphasise that those bids were all anonymised when the evaluation panel over the period March to August were looking at those bids. The bids were evaluated on a 50-50 price quality score, and overall the panel assessed FML's anonymised bid as achieving the top score overall. So in terms of when the decision was made, like I said, that was over the period March to August. We understand that then the CMAL board had to review the evaluation panel's assessment. FML had been identified as the leading bidder at that point. However, we're aware that on the 20th of August 2015, Transport Scotland submitted a paper to ministers to say that FML was the preferred bidder and said that the First Minister would be announcing this at a visit to the yard on the 31st of August 2015. We understand at that stage that CMAL and FML still had not negotiated the point over the builder's refund guarantee, and it wasn't indeed until after the announcement on the 31st of August that FML stated that it was unable to provide the 100% refund guarantee, and the best offer was a 25% refund guarantee.
Do you know who was on the evaluation panel?
I don't know the exact members, but I do know that CMAL and CalMac were involved.
CMAL and CalMac. Thanks. And so in September, FML confirms it is unable to provide a builder's refund guarantee, which was a mandatory requirement. Did FML give a reason why they could not give the builder's refund guarantee and why it had not been mentioned in their bid?
I said that the actual procurement process was out with the scope of this audit, so we don't have the details of FML's bid. But we do know that the pre-qualification exercise, it was made clear that the provision of a 100% refund guarantee was mandatory, and we know that FML passed that qualification stage because it was given the invitation to tender. The contract, the draft contract, which was part of the invitation to tender, made it clear that the builder's refund guarantee was mandatory. All bidders had the opportunity to provide comments on that draft contract, and FML did not, thus implying it was willing to offer the builder's refund guarantee.
So in September, CMAL advises Transport Scotland of the risks and states its preference to start the procurement process again. And it says later that Transport Scotland fully appraised Scottish ministers of the significant financial and procurement risks. In October, Transport Scotland advises CMAL that Scottish ministers are aware of the risk and are content for CMAL to award the contract to FML. So is there any documentation to show this and to explain the reasons why the contract still went ahead?
This is undoubtedly one of the key findings from our report, Deputy Convener, that with CMAL highlighting the extent of the risks, and as Jill rightly points out, that the importance of the provision of the guarantee, the 100% guarantee, is particularly significant in the context of a shipbuilding contract, because of the nature of the contract really allows for the builder to progress, and the transfer of risk rests with the shipbuilder. The buyer is insulated by the 100% guarantee, but in the circumstances where that didn't occur, as we have here, risk flows back to the buyer, albeit with a 25% offsetting and then an additional provision about final payment that offsets some of the risk. Anthony might want to comment a bit about the transparency point in a minute. What we're effectively seeing is that Transport Scotland advise ministers of the nature of the risks, allowing for CMAL's significant concerns and indeed position that the contract should be re-tendered. But the ministers took a view that they wish to proceed with the contract, cognizant of those risks. As we set out in the report, there is no documentary evidence of how those risks were considered or how intended they would be managed during the running of the contract. Transparency is hugely important. It matters that important decisions of this nature are set out and recorded, but through our audit work, we haven't been able to be provided with any evidence to set out how those risks would be managed. If I may, Deputy Convener, I may bring in Anthony, who want to say a bit more about how these circumstances work normally.
In these circumstances, one would expect the accountable officer in Transport Scotland to share their thoughts, their ideas, their risks, their concerns, and make proposals to Scottish ministers, upon which ministers can then reflect and make a formal decision. As the Auditor General has already indicated, one would expect that to be recorded and documented. In the circumstances of this audit, we requested the documentary evidence, but as the Auditor General has already said, none was forthcoming to us. So therefore, we're not in a position to offer advice to the committee on what thought processes took place and what advice Transport Scotland gave to ministers, or on what basis the Transport Minister, I think on this occasion, determined that they should recommend that the contract should proceed. As the Auditor General has already said, this is quite a significant finding, and I suspect it's something that the committee may wish to take evidence on in due course.
So there was no documentation at all to show the communication between CMAL, Transport Scotland, the ministers, or who had actually been spoken to? There was nothing at all that came out when we were doing the audit?
We made several requests to the Scottish Government and to Transport Scotland to receive information on this matter. None was forthcoming. I don't know if Jill has anything she wants to add to this.
Right, so what we did have was the submission that went to ministers around the risks, which set out CMAL's concerns, the clear risks. It also set out some of the amendments that CMAL had agreed with FML to try and mitigate some of those risks. And it also had set out some of the assurances that Transport Scotland were putting in place to kind of mitigate CMAL's concerns. And that was around the lines of CMAL not having to pay back the loan, the vessel loan, until the vessels were completed, and Scottish ministers looking favourably to CMAL's requests for additional funds if any of these risks came to pass. So we saw that documentation. But that part of that documentation, Transport Scotland had offered Minister to have a discussion with the CMAL board to discuss its concerns. We don't know if that went ahead. We asked for all documentation related to the Minister's decision. We asked that of Transport Scotland and Scottish Government, and we didn't receive any. So we are not clear if there was any discussions. We're not sure what discussions took place up to decide what the assurances that Transport Scotland would give CMAL. So we don't know on what basis ministers decided to accept the risks and to proceed with the contract award.
I think there are other members of the committee who want to come in on this point. So I'm going to bring them in. But just on this point, Jill Miller, that you made, and I direct this first of all to the Auditor General. If there is no documentary evidence, why not? Is it hidden? Is it missing? Or does it simply not exist?
We can only speculate on that point, Convener. I think, as Jill and Anthony have set out through our audit work, we request all relevant documentary evidence from public bodies in respect of our audit work. The Public Finance and Accountability Act 2000, Section 24, gives us rights of access and provision where there are circumstances that we know of the existence of a document, but that it's not being provided, that we can and have on occasion cited such provision to secure access. But where there are no relevant documentation to support a decision, that becomes harder. So we don't entirely know whether it's a case of there isn't a document that supports this important decision, or that we've asked for it and we weren't provided it. I suspect it's the former rather than the latter. But we can only speculate, Convener, and probably that would be unhelpful to do so.
OK, but potentially there could be a breach of the Act.
As I say, through our audit work, we ask for all relevant documentation. And I think, and especially given the significance of this that we've highlighted in the report, it's our understanding and the position that we've reached that there is no documentary evidence that supports the decision of such significance. And that led us quite clearly to the conclusion that we consider that there really ought to have been a level of documentation to understand why the scale of the risks so unusual in the extent of this contract were acceptable.
OK, thanks. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey at this point. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. It's on the point about the Builders' Refund Guarantee at the very beginning of the process. My understanding, having read the papers, Auditor General, is that within a standard sort of shipping model contract, that's assumed, that's embedded as part of the contract agreement. So it was assumed by default that FMail had consented to provide that guarantee 100%, but only a month later, they said they couldn't. Is that potentially a clear case of FML misleading the client at the outset of the contract?
I think, Mr. Coffey, as we've touched on, our report picks up at a certain point in terms of, we haven't reviewed the detail of the tender evaluation and procurement exercise, but we do note the significance of the Builders' Refund Guarantee in a shipbuilding contract. And the extent to which that insulates the buyer from risk and so forth. CMAL's position, and they'll of course have the opportunity, I'm sure, to restate this for themselves, that if a buyer doesn't raise an objection, whether it's about builder's guarantee or any other aspects of the contract, there is a tacit acceptance of the terms and conditions of the contract. That it became known at a later stage, shortly after the identification of the preferred bidder, that FML weren't in a position to offer the full 100% builder's refund guarantee, that presented the buyer and Scottish Government Transport Scotland ministers with an option to whether they wish to proceed or otherwise. But I think the position would be, as I suggest, a tacit acceptance of the terms and conditions unless otherwise stated.
Investigate why that guarantee was withdrawn within a month, or did they just proceed to make the best of the circumstances that they then found themselves in?
So Jill will want to say a wee bit more in a minute, but there were undoubtedly discussions between FML, CMAL in respect of the builder's guarantee and the position that was ultimately reached, and we set out some of this detail in the report that instead of the full 100% being offered, 25% builder's refund guarantee was eventually the position that was offered, along with some of the other mitigations that Transport Scotland were able to arrive at. But these don't equate to 100% builder's refund guarantee, and most importantly, the overall substance of it about the scale of the transfer of risk back into the buyer, as opposed to how you would expect to operate with a standard shipping contract, that the 100% guarantee provides the buyer with the surety in the event of circumstances going awry. Jill might want to say a bit more about how those events unfolded.
Yeah, so as we all know, FMail was a relatively new company. It was formed in October 2014, and CMAL was aware that as a new company with very little financial history, it might struggle to get a bank to provide it with a 100% guarantee. But CMAL had assumed that CBC, as FMail's parent entity, would provide a parent guarantee for FMail. We've obviously had discussions with CBC as well, and they said that that was never the case. But as the Auditor General has already said, the requirement for the full BRG was stated in the contract very clearly, and FMail did not make any comments on that contract. And therefore, when CMAL was evaluating its bid, there was no indication that it was not going to provide the 100% refund guarantee at that stage.
I'll leave it at that for the moment. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks. I think Craig Hoy has got some questions again in this area, so I'm going to turn to Craig to put some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Bond. Normally when you come before us, you bring reports that give us the complete picture. You put the pieces of the jigsaw together on how much money has been spent and the best value that's been achieved through that, and generally also there's an audit trail that underpins that. But today on two lifeline ferries for our island communities, we don't have that. Your report clearly identifies multiple failings, but there are key pieces of the jigsaw that are missing, and I think, as the convener said, either these have gone missing, they weren't produced, or they've been withheld from you. So My first question is perhaps just a bit wider than those that I'll turn to. But when all is told, over or close to £500 million could end up having been spent, first with a company owned by someone with close links to the party of government, the SNP, and latterly by a company owned by the government itself, how concerned should Parliament be and the public be that you've been unable to publish a report that tells the full story of how this money has been spent and why?
There's clearly a frustration, Mr. Hoy, from us that we weren't able to review all what we would consider to be the relevant evidence. I think, as I mentioned to the convener, I think our judgment is that is not that evidence has been withheld from us during the course of our audit work, but rather that an important piece of documentary evidence wasn't prepared to arrive at the judgment that ministers arrived at to accept the scale of risk so unusual in the scale of this contract and contrary to the advice of the public body CMAL that oversees the contract. So frustration, I'm sure it's a matter that civil service will want to reflect on about how they best document important decisions that significantly influence not just the use of public money but the provision of extremely important aspects of public services.
Paragraph 27 of your report, it says that on the 8th of October 2015, Transport Scotland advised Scottish ministers about CMAL's considerable concerns about awarding the contract to FMEL. We would have expected, obviously, any discussions to have been minuted in the company of civil servants and perhaps Transport Scotland, and no doubt there should have been note takers. But you say you have no insight into those discussions on the 8th of October. But what we do find out from the report is the very next day, Transport Scotland, or the day after Transport Scotland advised ministers of CMAL's concerns, ministers said that they were content to proceed. So there must have been some discussion during that day. That therefore does imply, however, that ministers were aware of the risks and that they therefore chose to ignore them in awarding that contract. Is that correct?
So that's our understanding. Not that there weren't any communications, but they haven't been documented, and that the CMAL's position, the extent of the risks, variation from the standard builder's guarantee in the contract, and that the risk flowing back to the buyers, public bodies, were part of those discussions. But as we've touched on, that those weren't adequately documented.
You would normally expect where there is a division between the civil service and ministers for there to be a ministerial direction issued. To your knowledge, was there no ministerial direction issued, and wouldn't it have been far better had there been such a document produced?
The Scottish Public Finance Manual sets out the provisions for such circumstances in Scotland. It refers to the term written authority as opposed to ministerial direction, which set out the circumstances where an accountable officer considers that they would be unable to achieve value for money in respect of implementation of a policy request from ministers. We don't believe that there was a written authority or ministerial direction requested from civil servants in these circumstances. And therefore, again, I'd be entering into the territory of speculation as to why one wasn't requested or otherwise. It is clear that it would have been an option had a civil servant considered that they wouldn't be achieving value for money, that they could have asked for such written authority. But it remains our understanding, Mr. Hoy, that no such request was asked.
Just rewinding a little bit, something that Jill said in relation to the awarding of the contract and the tender process, which I think is another key, perhaps, missing piece of the jigsaw. And I know that you, at the outset, talked about the scope of your report. But it has been suggested that, obviously, FML was the most expensive and potentially the highest quality, but yet not being able to give a refund guarantee. It is still being suggested that significant additional appointments were awarded for quality at some stage in that process. Have you had any sight of the actual tender scoring, and should it not now be published if it has not already been so?
I'll ask Jill to pick this one up.
Hi, so we did not look at that. However, we obviously reviewed the information that was given to the former REC committee's inquiry onto the procurement of these two vessels. And I understand that CMAL has provided the scores for each of the bids.
And just looking in relation to payments and milestones, just to move this on a little bit, again, there are potentially some missing pieces of the jigsaw here. Speaking to those in the industry, it appears that it's quite common for contracts for ships to have a payment schedule for 5 payments, but each of the contracts for 801 and 802 had 15 scheduled payments. Did you explore why this happened and who agreed to it? And isn't this alongside perhaps the failure to provide a refund guarantee and the plea for accelerated payments, further evidence of the financial fragility of FMIL?
Jill can come in again in a minute. I'm sure I want to say a bit more about variation in the use of milestone payments in this contract relative to the industry norm. But just before doing so, I think you mentioned, Mr. Hoy, about some of the financial circumstances of FMIL, and those are noted at various points in our report and indeed our public record before our audit work began about the additional financial support that was provided to the yard and alongside the variation of the use of milestone payments. So we do note that the use of, we set out Exhibit 3 in the report, the extent of milestone events and payments. But before handing to Jill, maybe just make the point, one of the points that became clear during our audit work, and perhaps at odds with other large public sector infrastructure contracts, is that the use of milestone payments in a contract didn't bear a direct relation to necessarily to quality or indeed progress, but that this is also the industry norm in shipbuilding for contracts. Jill, I'm sure I want to say a bit more to support the committee's understanding.
Yes, Mr. Hoy, you're correct that typically the payment schedule is 5 equal payments of 20%. However, it's not unusual for the buyer and the shipbuilder to agree a payment schedule that best suits the project. It's our understanding that during the period of discussions after FMIL was awarded, it was announced as preferred bidder and the contract being awarded in October, that there were 7 iterations of that milestone schedule suggested by FMIL to help ease its cash flow over the duration of the project. We discussed this with CMAL and they said that was not a concern to them, how they distributed the funding and when, because ultimately they were not paying more than the £97 million.
And just finally, if I can just close by just a question about the loan payments that the Scottish Government was making. It appears that the accelerated payments and the loans did point to a significant cause for concern in terms of cash flow at FMIL. The Scottish Government, certainly in relation to the first loan, was effectively secretly loaning the company up to £15 million and then latterly a further £30 million to keep a company afloat and certainly in positive cash flow terms so that it could continue to service another part of the government. And to a certain extent, there's almost a sort of Ponzi scheme at the heart of this. The government claimed that the original £15 million was commercially confidential, but that reasoning was dropped when the further £30 million loan was made available. Do you have any understanding why the government changed its tune in relation to the commercial confidentiality of those loans?
This was subject to consideration by the predecessor committee following receipt of, again, my predecessor's Section 22 reports on the Scottish Government. And if memory serves me correct, Mr. Hoy, where a loan is made on a commercial basis, as there were in these circumstances, that there wasn't an immediate obligation upon the government to inform the Scottish Parliament. That the £30 million loan was brought to Parliament's attention alongside the details of the £15 million loan that had been made earlier was a matter for the government. And I think we've set out our views on that, the need for transparency in such circumstances. But also linked to, again, a theme I'm sure I know the committee is interested in, about in more general terms, how financial interventions are made in private companies, the framework that supports that, the exit strategy, the financial terms, and so forth. But none of that detracts from the fact that, you know, where there are interventions of such scale, and particularly in these circumstances, that ought to be done as transparently as possible.
Thanks. And just one final quick question, if I may, convener. It appears that a significant number of senior management from FML, when they left, were then covered by non-disclosure agreements. Where significant sums of public money are involved, is it acceptable in your view that such agreements are put in place? And has this hampered your audit work in any respects?
In gathering evidence to support our report, we spoke to a wide range of people who were involved in the project, current and former officials. Jill can say a bit more, I'm sure, about the some of the detail of that. But we weren't able to speak to all of the former directors of FML that we were able to, because of the presence of the Non-Disclosure Act and the willingness of both the, not on the part of the individual, but the circumstances of the contract, which then fell to the administrators of FML and their willingness to give assurance that there would be no follow-through should somebody be seen to breach the terms of that. In overall terms, I don't think it has hampered our evidence gathering or the conclusions that we have reached. I think we set out in very clear terms the events that followed. But I should say, Mr. Hoyes, that there are many differing views about the events that took place at the Ferguson Marine and the progress of these vessels. And we note that a number of times in the report that the former owners of FML, CMAL, Transport Scotland, there is no consensus shared about why the events unfolded. Nonetheless, we look to, when we're undertaking our audit work, speak to as many people as possible. But it is fair to say that we weren't able to speak to one of the individuals who wished to participate in the audit work. If I may very briefly bring Jill in, I'm sure she wants to say a bit more about that.
I just like to say that we reviewed an extensive amount of evidence for this audit, covering a number of events over a six-year period. There's substantial evidence that we went through, a lot of documentation, we spoke to a lot of people. As public sector auditors, we were focused on the roles of the public sector organisations involved and their arrangements, setting up the contract, managing the contract, how it responded when it went wrong. So it was right that we focused our evidence on those. However, as the Auditor General has said, there were very conflicting views on what had gone wrong. It was very important for us to understand FML's view of events. FML have former management submitted a lot of information to the former REC inquiry into the project, so we reviewed all of that. We also spoke to one of FML's former chief executives and one of its former directors. There's also two directors currently at FMPG who formerly worked at FML, and we spoke to them about their experiences pre and post nationalisation. And we also spoke to the workforce representatives at FMPG who formerly worked for FML as well. So I feel that in the round we were able to get a good understanding of FML's point of view.
Thank you. Auditor General, can I just take you back to one of the questions which Craig Hoy put to you, and that was around written authority or ministerial direction, because I think this is quite central to the debate about transparency, accountability, and where decisions were made. Because, so when I review the correspondence that took place on the 8th of October and then the 9th of October, I do discern that there may have been written authority at work. So the email from Transport Scotland, which reflects CMAL's concerns about the risks associated with the contract, says the board would wish the minister to be appraised of these risks and to acknowledge to the board that he fully understood the potential risk of assigning a contract to FML under these circumstances. The board feel it is their absolute duty to point out the risks to their shareholder, and in that respect would expect approval should Scottish Government, with this project to proceed, would expect to receive direction to that effect. So they actually use the expression direction. quite explicitly in that correspondence. We then see within the space of 24 hours, the very next day, the reply is submitted, in which in a letter to Eric Ostergrad from the Director of Aviation, Maritime Freight and Canals Transport Scotland, dated the 9th of October, they say in paragraph 6, the Scottish ministers, both in their capacity as CMAL's sole shareholder and more generally, also confirm that CMAL is authorised, so they use that word, is authorised to enter into the contracts and any associated documentation. And paragraph 10 of that letter says, I can confirm that the Scottish ministers, plural, have considered and approved the contents of this letter. So it does look very much as though there was written authorisation, that there was ministerial direction, but it doesn't appear to have been recorded as required under the Act. Do you have any comments on that?
It's a fair assessment, convener, that the substance of the discussions were consistent with what I would understand to be ministerial direction or written authority, but the application of it were inconsistent with the requirements of the Scottish Public Finance Manual, one of which I should say is that the Auditor General for Scotland is informed in writing if there is an event that is identified as a request for written authority. No such information came to the Office of the Auditor General for Scotland during those discussions. So whilst there is an exchange of correspondence and clear setting out of the views, we didn't then see that translate into, I suppose, the formality, the record keeping that we would say is clearly consistent with the request for written authority.
But again, it could also represent a breach of the Public Finance and Accountability Act. If there was written authorisation, if there was ministerial direction and it was not recorded either with you or with the clerk of this committee, which is also one of the requirements of the Act.
So, Convener, I think we probably pushing up against some of the boundaries of our analysis of it and perhaps into the realms of legal judgment as to whether the events that took place are consistent with the Act or otherwise. What I'm clear on is that none of the government officials have identified that there was written authority requested from ministers and approved as such. And on that basis, we've not been able to say so and are clear in our judgment that there was no formal written authority.
Thank you. And obviously, we will have to consider as a committee how we can best seek to get to the bottom of that. We are limited for time, and I'm conscious that Colin Beattie has a series of questions which he wants to put. So I'm going to invite Colin to put those questions to you now, Auditor General. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, obviously this issue about the ferries first came about as a result of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's report of 9th December 2020, in which they asked you to carry out your investigation. And I presume that was what triggered your investigation at that time. Is that correct?
So I should say, Mr. Beattie, yes, of course, the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's review references their request for Audit Scotland to undertake further work. As the committee will be aware, is that I'm independent, I'm not directed by any particular committee of the Scottish Parliament in forming our work programme. So whilst we are absolutely cognisant of the work of the committee, I think, as I mentioned to Mr. Coffey a few minutes ago, is that our interest in ferries, the use of public finance and loans had been consistent for a number of years, which is fundamentally an issue of real public interest and public expenditure. So in drawing together all of those sources, we felt it was appropriate for us to undertake further work, and hence today's report.
Which is in line with your letter to the committee. The report itself obviously would have been something that you would have reviewed as part of your audit process in this. I assume that's correct.
Yes, of course.
Now, looking at the report, there are some very strong statements made in this report, most particularly paragraph 160, which says there is strong evidence that the contractor deliberately proceeds to construct specific section of the vessel, either out of sequence or not according to the proper specifications, purely as a means of triggering milestone payments on the contract. And again, paragraph 157, where evidence is given that work was carried out either incorrectly or out of sequence in order that bigger payments could be made against the contract. And interestingly, paragraph 158, where it says that invoices presented were rejected on the basis that related to other projects. Now, it seems clear that on the evidence taken by the committee, they had great concerns about the contractor. They also say in paragraph 153 that the lawyers, the CMAL, had advised that they had to make the payments that were called for because that was in the contract. And of course, they didn't want to be in a position where they broke the contract. Again, in paragraph 154, there's a statement here in the evidence that Ferguson's deliberately slowed down some of the subcontracting. Now, in your report, maybe I missed something, but I don't see directly where you've addressed that, because this is very serious. It's very serious indeed. And if what the Rural and Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee concluded is correct, then what action needs to be taken is the question.
So there's some very significant sections of the Rural Economy Committee's report that you reference, Mr. Beattie, in terms of work being undertaken out of sequence, allegations to trigger payments not done correctly, invoices relating to other projects and so forth. As I mentioned at the start of evidence this morning, we took a view about the scope of our work, as we always do with any audit, that our work would be best served by picking up this matter following the Rural Economy Committee's report and looking at the circumstances after the identification of FMEL as the preferred bidder, rather than repeating much of the extensive evidence that the Rural Economy Committee took about the nature of the procurement, the design, the contract. Clearly, we are not shipbuilding experts. And we also know, in particular in arriving at the judgment about the scope of our work, that there were conflicting expert views about the nature of how this contract ought best to be operated. Independent experts who disagreed. And therefore, our judgment that we arrived at, that we'd be better looking at the use of public money after the identification of the preferred bidder. None of that detracts from the examples that you provide. I should say that there were clearly very significant events during the course of the running of the contract. But I think, as we reasonably, I think, and consistent with the Rural Economy Committee position, is that there is a significant disagreement between FMEL and CMEL over how the contract was running. Mediation and arbitration was explored between the parties, and eventually the position, as we set out in our report, was that the course of action that CMEL and the government recommended to FMEL was that they pursue this through the court of session. Clearly, FMEL took a view that wasn't possible for them, and, as we know, subsequently entered into administration.
But, I mean, the conclusions reached by the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee have serious implications, and they do need to be addressed, surely. Because if there is this level of contractor failure, that has contributed massively to the costs and the delays in this project.
Yeah, So we would, I think as we finalise the report, we recommend that there needs to be a fuller review. Lessons learned feels too glib to describe the circumstances before us, Mr. Beattie, of the circumstances that took place in arriving at a contract that is many years late, 2.5 times the original budget, to establish how these ought to be delivered in the future. We haven't done that in its entirety, given the fact that, as I mentioned about the work of the Rural Economy Committee, that the project is still being undertaken. But we share the substance of your concern that there needs to be a fuller review. And we're pleased that some of our recommendations have already been acknowledged by CMAL about the adequacy of the contract, the need for the review of milestone payments to be more closely aligned to quality and progress. But I'm quite sure that there will be more reviews that will follow the consideration of our report.
Your report has not addressed the issue of contractor failure and the impact of that, because I don't see it in your report. The Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee has certainly raised the flag on that. I would have thought it would be a priority to look at. I mean, that's our public money that has been paid out to this company that has not, according to the evidence of this committee, it's not been paid out in the manner in which it should have been. And yet it's been paid out according to contract by CMAL on the advice of their lawyers.
I'll maybe bring Anthony in. He wants to come in a moment. I'm not sure I would agree entirely with your assessment that the report doesn't identify concerns or problems in terms of the running of the contract or the work of the contractor. I think I would point to the report that we reference of the turnaround director upon entering their role about the scale of operational failures in the yard, the extent of issues, as the Deputy Convener mentioned in her question, the extent to which the management of assets, warranties and so forth, the very recent further information about the quality of cabling and so forth that's been uncovered. So very significant, to again refer to the words of the former turnaround director, operational failures in the yard, and that will no doubt have contributed to the late running of the contract. What we also say in today's report, though, is that there are many accountabilities and reasons why we are in the circumstances that we are today, the performance of the contractor being one of those. But if I may, I'll bring Anthony. I think he's more to comment on this point.
I was going to highlight the points that the Auditor General has already made in terms of reference to the Turnaround Director's report and the deficiencies it highlighted in the management of the shipyard pre and to an extent post-nationalisation. The other point I wanted just to draw out, if I may, is the very clear reference in the report to the weaknesses in the contracting arrangements, which in the absence of a builder's refund guarantee placed real risk, I think, to the Scottish Government and others in the use of public money. If you look at paragraphs 33 of the report onwards, Mr. Beattie, we highlight the deficiencies in terms of the contract, setting out CMAL's and FMAL's responsibilities for managing the project, but it's very clear that the milestones weren't clearly defined and weren't linked to quality standards. And you yourself, Mr. Beattie, have acknowledged the fact that CMAL took legal advice on this and found themselves obliged to make the payments, even if there were perhaps concerns about aspects of quality and delivery of the ship.
It just seems such a big and fundamental gap in the overall picture here. And again, I'm coming back. I mean, I'm relying here on the good work of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. I don't see where that's been built on in the Audit Scotland report in order to bring out that part of it, which is so critical. And yes, we can all argue about the contract and so forth, and there's a huge amount of documentation online and has been online for some time in connection with that. But how are we going to address that? Because that question mark is still sitting out there now about the failure of the contractor. And the Minister who came back in response to the committee report, highlighted the fact that he felt even that report didn't really reflect in full the contribution of the contractor's non-performance contract management and financial management described in independent evidence. So why are we being so precious about this? If there's an issue here, if there's evidence pointing to non-performance by the contractor, which has contributed to charges on the public purse, if there's been applications for funding which have not been, shall we say, done in the correct way, all that should be brought out and highlighted.
I think I would respond. So we absolutely recognise that the work of the contractor is, of course, part of the story of where we are today, set out very clearly in the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's report. As we touched on already, about how we arrived at the judgment as to where our work was best focused, in building on the work of the Rural Economy Committee, recognising that there are many differing views about the circumstances that we are in today. But if I may perhaps just repeat the point that Anthony makes about public sector contracts do fail. You know, so the Ferguson shipbuilding circumstances aren't the first. So but where the contract is properly used, it provides insulation to the public body to end the contract should they so wish. And I think these are the unique circumstances of this contract, is that the transfer of risk under the typical shipbuilding contract that would normally rest with the contractor wasn't properly applied. And therefore, the risk came back to the public sector body. And usually, where in such circumstances, they would typically rest with the shipbuilder. And those are the points that, you know, amongst others that we sought to reference. I think in terms of the work of the contractor, Mr. Beattie, I'm sure, and I think as we make the recommendation, is that that will be subject to further consideration. And again, apologies for repeating myself, but I think we do recognise that is part of the story, and particularly reference the judgment arrived by the turnaround director and the extent of operational challenges, failures in the shipyards once they were subject to review.
I mean, we've talked a lot about the contract, and we can argue about different aspects of that, but contracts are really only there when things go wrong, so that there is something to refer to. Here we have a situation where, again, referring to the committee report, the allegations are that the company did not act in the proper way in order to receive the correct payments. Now, that to me is, as I say, contracts are there when things go wrong, but generally speaking, you don't expect things to go wrong. Generally speaking, you know, delivery is made in goodwill and all the rest of it, and parties work together. This has not taken place. So, you know, there's a lot of questions around this, and these questions are going to get bigger and bigger. I would ask if you're going to carry out an investigation to ensure that the contractor's apparent failures are highlighted, or that they may be explainable. I don't know. But at the moment, this is where the big questions are.
In terms of the number of points for me trying to address all of those, we'd agree that, you know, the contracts are there to be enforced, you know, for good times and for bad, and provides both the provider and the purchaser with safeguards. Clearly, in the circumstances of the application of the traditional shipbuilding contract, the industry standard, are not what, as we've mentioned already, we would expect to see in a public sector context, but nonetheless, those are the industry standards. But the absence of the 100% builder's refund guarantee meant that the risk grew for the public sector body. And when circumstances went awry, as they did here, is that that then risk and additional payments flew to the Scottish public sector. I mean, Jill might want to come in again. I think talk about the payment schedule and the fact that that wasn't aligned with the quality of the work. And that's clearly a significant part of the story. And as we've mentioned and set out in the report, that CMAL have already responded to that part of the recommendation, that that is much more closely connected in future matters. Lastly, before bringing Jill in, of course, we will reflect on what further work we can undertake to add further to the circumstances. We won't arrive at that judgment today, Mr. Beattie. I think we will reflect as to any further evidence sessions, and particularly the recommendation that we finalise the report on for CMAL and the other public bodies to undertake a full review, lessons learned of the events that took place.
Question to yourself is, all that money that was paid in, where did it go? What was it spent on? Because it wasn't in the yard when it was nationalised. Simple question.
So there's a combination of things. Jill, again, I may want to cover both of these points and some of the detail of it. When we arrive at the £240 million and the analysis of that, Jill can set out, we include both the amounts paid to the contractor and also the loans that the Scottish Government provided to it, some of which that it was able to recover through the administration process and the valuation of the assets that were on the yard at the time of nationalisation. But clearly, you know, the scale of money that was invested didn't bear any resemblance to what was initially anticipated that would be delivered for such a size of public sector investment. Jill, are you able to cover both those points?
Yes. Your first point, Mr. Beattie, on contractor failure, I just want to make clear that we were very limited in what we could say about Ferguson Marine because it was a private sector organisation. So although we did speak to them and reviewed a lot of documentation, we could not report any issues that we found with its spending, with its decision making, etc. What we could do was report what CMAL was reporting to Transport Scotland and to the Programme Steering Group, and I think we have said that in several places, that it started highlighting that there was issues with FMAIL's performance as early as December 2015, so only 2 months after the contract was awarded. We were not able to say ourselves whether or not we found those, one, because Ferguson Marine no longer exists, so we couldn't go in and see for ourselves. But as I said, we didn't have that remit to make those judgments about a private sector organisation. I think, though, we make the point very clearly that CMAL was consistently reporting issues with the contractor. But I also think it's very clear that FMAIL completely disagrees and it has a different point of view, and it firmly believes that CMAL was responsible for the delays to the project. In terms of the out-of-sequence working that you mentioned, we have mentioned that in the report. FMAIL itself admitted in evidence to the REC committee that it did engage in out-of-sequence working just to try and keep the project moving, and that was due to delays with CMAL approving the designs. We have spoken to independent shipbuilders who said that out-of-sequence working isn't necessarily an issue, and it can take place, to keep the project moving and to make for more efficient at working. But CMAL reported that FMAIL's approach in out-of-sequence working was an issue and caused problems with the project. In relation to the £14.55 million that you mentioned in the invoices that were submitted that were not related to the project, that specific point, so this was an agreement that ministers had made with FMAIL for CMAL to accelerate the £14.5 million before the CMAL board had made that decision. Ministers had agreed with FMAIL that would take place, and CMAL only agreed to it subject to very tight controls, which was FMAIL must submit all the invoices related to the project. CMAL would review them and make sure that all of the money that they were accelerating to FMAIL was being spent on the suppliers, equipment, etc. for the vessels. And our understanding is that there were some invoices that were submitted by FMAIL that were not directly linked, but CMAL refused those. So there was no public money spent on well, none of that £14.55 million was given to FML to spend on anything else. In relation to the where the money went, that's a question that we asked several times. So CMAL paid £83.25 million out, but as we set out in Exhibit 6 of the report, there was a significant amount of work outstanding. I think typically, on a typical project with a 100% refund guarantee, that provides a significant financial incentive for the builder to build a quality product. Because that guarantee wasn't in place, that same level of incentive was not there. That therefore placed more importance on there being a very clear link between the payments that CMAL was making and the quality of the build. And as we say, that link wasn't there. So CMAL was legally required to make the payments, but because the milestones weren't clearly defined, I think that's what caused the issues. So the money was being paid out and the build, the vessels weren't being constructed as we would have expected. The £45 million loan from the £45 million loans from the Scottish Government. The first loan, £15 million, which was made specifically for vessel progress, was drawn down very quickly by FML, £13 million within 2 months. And that was because it had a substantial number of outstanding invoices. They had suppliers who were threatening to withhold equipment, materials, etc. They had subcontractors threatening to walk off site. So that money was very quickly drawn down and made very little difference to the project. The second loan, the £30 million loan, although PwC were providing the Scottish Government with reports on FML spending, they didn't go into the level of detail of where that money went. So we weren't able to trace exactly how that money was spent and what progress was made on the vessels. But we were told that suppliers were paid, the workforce was paid, and that enabled that kind of stopped any legal action against FML and allowed progress on the vessels to continue.
We're really running short of time. Yes, I think. Well, I think the point is, I think we've all got a lot of more questions, and that's one of the reasons why I think we've demonstrated. That we really do need to have at least another session to look at this. I didn't, and I know there are members of the committee who wanted to come back in, myself included. I did mention at the start of the session that Rhoda Grant was joining us remotely, and so for the final couple of minutes we've got, I'm going to invite Rhoda to put any questions that she wants to put to the team who are here with us. Rhoda.
Thank you, convener, and I appreciate that. But as others, I have a lot more questions, but I'll keep my questions quite short as to get some clarification. Listening to the session, it seems to me clear that there was communication that was documented between CMAL and Transport Scotland, but it was Transport Scotland that came back to CMAL with ministerial decisions. Is there any paperwork regarding Transport Scotland's discussions with ministers, how they put that to ministers and which ministers responded?
Just ask Jill to talk through the chain of events again. Jill.
There was no documentation to explain any of the discussions, the assurances that Transport Scotland put in place, which they agreed with ministers, which allowed CMAL's board to agree to approve the contract. We did ask for all documentation related to the minister's decisions and we did not get any.
Okay, so there is nothing regarding ministerial decisions and how that was carried out documented. I also understand that that decision was taken within a day. Would that be normal? How would you normally expect a decision of that magnitude to be taken within government?
I'm not sure we would be able to give you a precise or reasonable comparator to this decision. Some decisions will be taken at pace and some will be more considered depending, I'm sure, on the availability of ministerial diaries and so forth. I think the point that we look to set out very clearly in the report, though, is that where decisions of significance are taken and where the risks are coming back to the public sector, those ought to be documented for public record.
and at the level at which they are taken. At which level would you expect such a decision of this magnitude to be taken?
So it varies. Apologies, Ms. Grant. It varies. I guess what we look to set out at Exhibit 2 of the report is the range of accountabilities and responsibilities. And in the circumstances of the awarding of the ferries contract, that those rested with ministers. So yes, we would expect that to be documented. But I think the unusual circumstances here is that the contracting body, CIMAL, identified additional risk outside of the standard terms and conditions of the contract, the builder's guarantee point that we've talked about already this morning. The fact that that context was applicable all pointed to the fact that it needed to be well documented as to the acceptance of those risks and how they would be managed.
Okay, thank you.
Right, thank you very much. And we are literally out of time. And so I'm going to draw this session to a close and thank the Auditor General, Anthony Clark, Angela Canning and Jill Miller for joining us this morning, and extend an invitation to you to return at the earliest opportunity that we can make. Thank you for your evidence this morning. We've got a whole load more questions that we need to ask. We've got some consideration to give to what our next steps might be, but I do want to thank you for your openness and willingness to answer the questions we've put to you this morning. So with that, I'll move the committee into private session. Thank you.